see that soil is in my blood. Coming from a long line of farmers and growers, agriculturalists, people who looked after the land. But one day, my blood was literally in the soil. Let me take you back to the 1970s in the countryside of Angus, where we had tatty holidays. You remember? Tatty holidays, where we picked potatoes. We were out in the outdoors with our friends, exercising in the fresh air, having fun and having breaks. But one year, I took it a bit too far. I climbed on top of the bogie, the trailer, and someone came behind me and pushed me, and I fell. I fell into the ground and fractured my leg in two places, an open fracture, the blood seeping down. I drifted in and out of consciousness. I saw the sky above me and the clouds drifting past. Eventually, I was rescued. After a period of recovery, I was allowed to go home. And while I was at home, I couldn't climb the trees and run around the countryside like I liked to do. That was no longer the case. So I turned to books. I liked Agatha Christie, but I also loved Sir Arthur Conan Doyle's books. Remember the Sherlock Holmes books? Sound of the Baskervilles, Sign of the Four. Many of his stories included soil science. He was fantastic about science. He engaged his readers. He used the medical knowledge that he had. He was also an avid botanist. And in the Sign of the Four, he described the red mud that was on a visitor's shoes, which identified which part of London that the visitor had been. Wigmore Street in London, to the particular place where he had been. Little did I know that in 20 years later, I'd be using those same principles of transfer of soil to someone or an object that can tell us where they have been. The next phase of my life was when I went to university, from the idyllic countryside of Angus to the big city of Edinburgh. When I got there, I moved into halls of residence, enjoying sailing, running, going up Arthur's Seat, having a wonderful time, and also learning too. But while I was there, I went back to my halls of residence room, which overlooked Salisbury Crags and Arthur's Seat. And on the news came the announcement, two young girls had been found in the fields outside Edinburgh, one at Gosford Bay and one in the fields at Huntington Coates. They'd been gagged and bound and left with no dignity. No one was found for these murders for a long, long time. It was the world's end for those girls that day, Christine Eady and Helen Scott, and their families and friends. Life would never, ever be the same for them, ever again. And these investigations got the iconic term, the world's end murders. Unfortunately, no one was found. And we, as students, young girls, living and studying in Edinburgh, our lives changed. No longer would we go home alone to our flats or halls of residence, but we'd go together, or we'd get the bus or a taxi. No more home late from the library at night going through the meadows. That all stopped. Our lives had changed, but not as much as the lives of the families and friends of poor Helen and Christine. But I carried on with my studies in soil science, and I came up to Aberdeen, the lovely city that it is. And part of the privilege of being a researcher is that you get to meet other people. You get to go to conferences and attend various meetings. And in April 1999, I was in London at a meeting. And at that time, I also liked watching programs such as Crime Watch. And I thought Jill Dando was an amazing woman. She was, to me, the Lady Diana of presenting. And one day, just as she was about to get married, she was going home to her own house in the streets of London, and she was shot dead. Her life was taken. Her world ended, and that of her family and friends at that point in time. So, an investigation went underway very rapidly with multiple lines of inquiry. But very soon, a suspect, Barry George, was identified. Barry George lived nearby where Jill Dando lived, and he very quickly, evidence was produced. Evidence of a particle of gunshot residue that was found in his pocket. Using a very high power microscope, they identified that that particle was exactly the same type as the particle that they recovered from Jill Dando's hair. That was quite a crucial piece of evidence that was presented and used in his trial. In 2001, he was found guilty and sent to prison. However, we have to consider alternative propositions in forensic science. Where else could that single particle of gunshot residue have come from? This is London. There are undergrounds. There are armed police. So a report was sent to the courts, which said, considering the single particle of gunshot residue that was found in Barry George's pocket, it was just as likely that he did not kill Jill Dando as kill her. So in 2008, in an appeal court, he was acquitted and released from prison. To this day, they have still not found who killed Jill Dando. We consider the alternative proposition, as I've said, but let's think about it. Let's think about if I see you and you have just been to a wedding, you've confetti in your hair, in your shoulders, in your clothes. It's safe to assume that you've likely just been to a wedding. However, if I meet you and you've got a single piece of confetti in your pocket, it's more likely that you have picked up that piece of confetti by going to a pub and meeting someone that has been to a wedding. So we don't always take things at face value. We consider the evidence and the evidence in context. So moving forward to 1984, and I can't do a talk without mentioning DNA, and Sir Alex Jeffreys, who discovered the individual nature of DNA and how DNA is individual to a single person, apart from identical twins, that is. But each one of you will leave behind particles in your seat, which would let us know where you have sat here today. You have been here and you will have left traces. So that tells us who has been there. And what happened at this time was a database was built up, a searchable database, the combination of computing science, biology and chemistry all came together. And at that time, a Mr. Angus Sinclair was in prison, in Peterhead Prison, a lifetime sentence for the abduction and rape of 11 young girls. And as it happens, their DNA is put into the database. And his DNA was an actual match for the DNA that was found at both Christine Edie and Helen Scott's sites where they were found. That wasn't enough, however. It wasn't enough because he said that it was consensual sex. So we have to consider what other evidence can be developed. Crime light was a new method that was developed at that time. And I'll come back to this later in the talk. But what it does is it shines a light on where the DNA is on the person or object. So it combines the who with where to let the investigators work out what happened. So let me go back to my life now. And in 2000, I was working away at the then Macaulay Institute in Aberdeen, and along came Police Scotland, or at that time, that was Grampian Police, and said, we've got this spade, there's some soil on it. Can you help us and work out where it might have been used? We've got some intelligence, there's some drugs buried in a woodland near here. So I took the soil, and myself and my colleagues, we ran it through a whole load of tests, we compared it with a database that we had of soils, and we quickly narrowed it down to a specific woodland with specific types of trees on a counterswell series soil. Went there, and the drugs haul was indeed buried in that woodland. My passion for forensic soil science was firmly established at that time. Then, in 2003, it was Lothian and Borders Police that got in touch. And they said, we've got samples that were kept, soil samples that were kept from 1977 in the World's End murders. Would you be able to have a look at them and tell us if they can help us identify where the people had been? Of course, we could apply those same principles that I'd read about many years before, that to develop a discipline that was strategic, it was quantitative, it was robust. So we did that, we looked at it, and we could show that indeed Helen, the soil on her feet, was from that field where she was found. But that wasn't enough. What we did was we developed other techniques, organic biomarkers, which could identify at the scale of a footprint where someone had stood. And that led us to build up a picture that indeed poor Helen had walked. She had walked from the edge of the field where the caravanette that she'd been abducted into, she'd walked over the grass verge and into the field to her death. The combination of identifying individual aggregates of soil from her feet and the methodology that had developed to the point that we could apply those biomarkers to those individual samples. Several samples, multiple samples, not just one. So the prosecutors, the investigators, came to the conclusion that Angus Sinclair had indeed taken those girls and killed them. And indeed, Helen Scott had walked to her death. The biology, the DNA, had told them with the crime light and the DNA that he had tied the knots in the ligature in their neck. The soil had showed that she'd been alive and walked to her death, and the semen on the coat had put a time on that when he blamed his brother-in-law and he said he'd gone fishing. But in 2014, he was found guilty, and he was sentenced to 37 years, a year for every year that the families of these girls had to wait to see justice brought. Ironically, in that year, later, more developments came to fruition, and we could then show that the past, a blood stain the size of a 50 pence piece was necessary to get DNA. But now the rim of a glass is enough to have enough DNA that tells that it was you that drank out of that glass. In the past, we would have to have a handful of soil. Now we can analyze soil the size of a grain of rice. And in 2019, Crime Watch presented a whole feature on the World's End murders. And that very day, Angus Sinclair died. So we can say who did something by the DNA on the object. We can say where someone has come from by the soil on their shoes. But that doesn't tell us about how it got there. If your neighbor shakes your hand and your neighbor goes and kills someone with a knife, your DNA is on that knife. If your friend borrows your car and they go and bury someone in a grave in a wood, the soil from that gravesite is in your car. So it's the how that is so important. The data must be reproducible, fair, and robust and tested. You may think, what is it to do with me? I'm not a scientist, I'm not a lawyer, I'm not a police person. You're a public citizen. What if you were the victim of a crime? What if your family, someone you knew, were falsely accused of committing a crime? You would want the truth to be heard. You would demand that justice be served, but you would want it to be fair, true, and reproducible. So who knows what's going to happen in the future? Who knows what the next exciting scientific development is going to be? Could be soil DNA. It could be environmental DNA. Who knows? We have to keep the curiosity of the young children to discover the new discoveries that will help solve the cold cases and the cases yet to come. And we've got to fund them. We've got to fund them appropriately that the data is robust to produce future sound science so that just decisions can be made, so that we can all help with sound science to provide the evidence to be the silent, to help and to be the people that help the silent victims of crime.